Sir, what would you like to say about the third wave of Indian IT industry?
I've been talking a lot about the third wave over the last 2 or 3 years, and the basic hypothesis there is any industry goes through transformation. I mean, if you take electronic components, first, let's say Southeast Asia became a component supplier to the world. Then they started manufacturing on an OEM basis. And finally, they started creating their own brands, whether you take a Lenovo or a Haier or brands like that. So we see IT also going through a very similar transformation, where first, as component suppliers in IT, you cannot supply components, but we supplied people. So the early 70s, 80s was largely staff aug, body shopping type engagements, where the industry established that Indian IT professionals were best, could compare with the best in the world. The second wave was OEM, which happened around the Y2K time, where people understood that you could get packets of work done by India, you could get the programming, the actual software delivery, development, testing, delivery done out of India, under specs from international clients. So it pretty much resembles the OEM concept of electronics. So now is clearly the time for the industry to make the next leap, to become brands, to become a strategic partner to their clients, and to do work which is much higher impact and far more strategic and transformational. So that's precisely what I believe is the third wave opportunity for India. So if India and IT has to grow beyond its current level of 20, 25 billion to 100 billion in IT, just on the services solutions component, it cannot happen just on a linear model. So we believe third wave is the way to go when it comes to growth of Indian IT as a sector.
What would you like to say about the attractiveness of India?
Oh, India is very attractive in a global context, largely because of the pool of labor we have, the additions to the labor pool that we create, and the level of talent that has built over the last 10-15 years in the industry. So, India in the world software context is there to stay. I think almost everyone has recognized that India is mainstream, and there is a significant part of their software development which has to happen out of India.
What are the unique strengths of your company?
What Mastek has traditionally been strong at, if you know, we've been in business now for 26 years. We started in 1982. And the name Mastek actually evolved from management and software technology. So when we came into business, we understood that business could leverage technology, but the average business user or the leader did not really understand technology too much. At the same time, we had bright youngsters who understood software, who understood computers, but they didn't have a business grounding. So four of us as management graduates, what we wanted to achieve was to act as a bridge between the business community and the technologists, and that's how the name Mastek itself was coined. We thought that over a period of time, we may run out of opportunities and go out of business because the business guys will understand IT and the IT guys will understand business. But fortunately or unfortunately, the rift has actually increased over a period of time, and we see our role far more relevant today than we were 26 years back in 1982 when we started.
Segment-wise, how your company is positioned?
Basically, where we play is actually the high-end solutions game. So we focus on enterprise solutions. We look at customers' transformation programs. What are the kind of initiatives they have? For as an example, let's say what we did for London, the city of London. The mayor Ken Livingstone wanted to reduce congestion by 15 to 20%. So along with our partner Capita, we put together a solution which could actually improve the traffic situation in London by charging at that point it was a £5 fee to get into London on a daily basis. So these are the kind of transformation objectives that clients have, and we look at what are the IT platforms which can enable business transformation. Ultimately, IT cannot produce a result for a business. It can only be an enabler for businesses to actually produce a result. So our focus is transformation, and the strengths that we bring, I think at the core of Mastek, is our ability to architect a solution. We can look at a customer's business problem, business strategy, business situation, and convert it to IT, both from an architecture, design, development, delivery, in a very predictable fashion.
How your strategy of slowing down on BPO is paying off?
See, actually, we were never very strong in BPO. We thought that we could create an industry focus in, let's say, the check processing segment within banks with a partnership through a company called Carriker in the US. Once Carriker got acquired, that partnership didn't get anywhere, and so we're just running down our current client contract. So it's not a significant part of our business either way. And we will continue as long as our current customer contracts continue.
Your company was declared the best company under a billion list by Forbes. So what are the latest highlights you would like to mention?
Okay, that happened in the past. Now we are looking at how we can be considered the best company over a billion over the next 4 or 5 years.
What's the impact of slowdown?
We've definitely taken a hit because our business is around new initiatives, and we find that over the last quarter there has been a second order, third order effect across industries, across the globe, and especially in the major markets that we play, which is the UK and the US. So we do see a slowdown in terms of customer spending. There have been delays in starting up new initiatives, and that has impacted us. So we thought this year we would grow at about 30-35% in rupee terms, but as of January, when we gave our targets for the year, we reduced it to about 10-15%. So we've definitely taken our share of it based on the slowdown.
How best you are hedging your risk in foreign exchange?
See, we've taken a different approach to foreign exchange. We don't get into exotic contracts. We just do a forward contract which covers our receivables, confirmed receivables, over the next 3 months or so. So to that extent, I mean, we move in line with the market, and we don't. So if you take it, because a lot of our business, 65% of our business comes out of UK in British pounds. As the pound weakened this quarter, we had to take a hit.